California, a place I know right well. So fare thee well, my own true love, but when I return, united we will be. It's not the leaving of Liverpool that pleases me, but my darling, when I think of thee.
This is where we grew up, me and my mates, on this car park here. This is where we play footy. You see the goal there? There's our goal, and we had another goal on that fence there. And we'd have up to like 20 lads playing on one night on here. And if your car was still parked here, it'd be full of dents in the morning. We just play around the car, unless it was in the goal. This is the street where I grew up too, yeah. This is the street where I grew up here, Fontenoy Street. That was my auntie's house. This still is my auntie's and my family's house there. So everything was local. It was like a small little community. Everybody knows everyone. Like, there's my school there. That was my junior school. Holy Cross. There's the playground where I learned the box. And there's my house there where I grew up. That's where I grew up, and that was my school there. I don't know, I was late every single day.
Me and Jazza go back a long way. We boxed for the same amateur club, the Solly, and then Jazza decided to leave us. Left the Solly, went to a few clubs, then ended up at the RT. He had an excellent pro career with the RT, and then, you know, in life things go stale and you need fresh changes, and he decided, you know, he was going to come in here and see what we could offer him. And he come in a couple of weeks before he headed out to LA, Miami. He went to Miami, come in here, told me he was going there, and then I just said to him, you know, go and see what it's about and come back and see what you felt like in here. And then one day he come in, done a little session, and he said to me, would you be interested in training me? And obviously I had to go and take that to George, who's the main man. I said to George, Jazz wants to come on board and be a part of the team. And you know, me and George know Jazza from a long time, but basically, you know, we live in the same community. We know what he's about, we know he's dedicated to the sport. So we took him on board. We wanted him a part of the team, and you know, hopefully we can move him in the right direction. In camp, everything we've asked him to do he's going to be hopefully British champion again very soon.
As you can see within the city centre, really, it's just like a little smaller community. There's really old city there. It's just a small community. The school teachers actually told me that I wouldn't do well in boxing. So I kicked out of school. I had a little bit of resentment after the teacher told me that, but I think being from where I am from, I'm very lucky really. No city centre, there's a lot to do indeed early. More than you actually know. But mostly it was football and boxing. But I didn't find boxing until I was like 13. But the lads, we all bonded over football, and that was what we do mostly. Football and manhunt. German bastards.
was it a footballing family then, yours? Like you say, your dad run the club, and that was, you know, that was always around you, and that's what you did growing up mainly.
Yeah, well, in my school he was 10 lads, so we had our own football team in our year in school, and then we had the school team. We actually got to the final and won at Goodison 1 year, the Merseyside Cup. It was just football, everything was football. We go back out, we play after school, we play football in school, we play football after school, we play football together on the weekend. So football was what bonded us all together. It's a shame really, because I don't get to see the boys enough. Not with my career and my family and stuff like that now.
Yeah, you don't
but
see
the,
them.
But the lads are all dead close, we all still live down here, where we're from. Just don't get to see them enough really. It's something I'd like to do a lot more of, but I just don't get the time much anymore. Still got the same connection with the lads, and the lads are the lads, and that they always will be, but just don't get to see them often.
Here we go.
Luke, on the end. Did I call your old mates? Did they come and follow you around to the boxing now? Did he come?
Yeah, they always have done. I remember that my first amateur fight. It was in a little club called we got Old Park Ballroom, and I remember the row of me mates all sitting there, and one of them shouted, "Jazzy!" And I looked at him, and he never said nothing, and I got it. And I never really forget coming out the ring and seeing me lads, me mates, all the lads sitting there, Kevin, Martin, Louis, just all, and you know, like the boys who grew up with from nursery, we all grew up. So, yeah, so even now, they come to fight, every fight, boss.
Great city, Liverpool, defined by sport, the teams, you know, the boxers over the years, and I was a big John Conte fan myself when I was young, but, you know, being a proud scout, so what is Liverpool, what does it mean to you, how has it moulded you as a person, as a character and as a boxer?
When you say Liverpool, for me, I put it into one thought, and it's the people of Liverpool, it's got this way about them, especially the older boys, you look, the way they are, the way they talk, the way they speak, the kindness of them, just the actions, the way they are, I can't really explain it, you'd have to relate to it to understand what I'm trying to say, but the people, the kindness, it's got something special about it in the city. I think the city, well maybe for me in my life, a lot's changed really, because there's a lot of students now. As I live in the city centre, it's a packed city anyway, isn't it? So the dynamics have changed a little bit recently here in Liverpool, but when you get the old boys and you get a bit of time and you remember, it's just a lovely city, just the people, the kindness of them, special. And the support they give to as a fighter, they love boxing and they love football. Like, what are you doing on the weekend? They're going out and they're in town, they're going to match or they're going to the boxing. There was a show on last night, and like Sir Callum Smith, people going to Germany to watch him. So the support and the pool is just unbelievable for boxers. They love boxing, you know.
It's produced a lot of quality boxers over the years. You know, there's a lot of gyms, isn't it, spread across the city, and you know, it was the docks there, you know, and you had all the people coming from all around the world. It bred that kind of, you know, that tough. In a strengthening people, didn't it? You know, and then you know, a good breeding ground, I suppose, over the years for boxers. You've had some great ones come from it.
And that is where we are now, about 2 miles surrounding this area, is probably like 8 gyms, boxing gyms. And I think you deserve the credit. They're like the oldest, the community heroes, really, aren't they? You know, the people who give the time every single night to go to the gym and coach kids that they don't even know. You go to the gym to teach your kids and look after your kids and bring your kids through. So they're like, they're heroes. They're our city's true heroes. Them people who spend the time every single night giving the time to the kids. And the kids don't like, you don't even appreciate them. You come home and you go, "You're fucking moaning at me again. That our cunt." That's just the way it is, isn't it? But you don't really appreciate these people who've given 30 and 40 years to boxing, and then they die and they go on a box and then they're forgotten about, do you know what I mean? And then some fucking shitty ass kid like me comes through, does well, wins a few national titles and gets all the credit. So I think they deserve the real, you know, all the real credit for it.
Respect, yeah. Do you know when did you first realise that people knew who you was, and you started to, you know, the media got you out there, and you'd been on the telly and stuff like that. When people started recognising you, and that, you know, where you felt like you had a responsibility to, you know, to be this person who people looked up to.
It's a little bit uncomfortable in a way. There was a documentary made on Channel 4 a few years ago, and I think that was the first big thing. Like thousands of people following me and stuff like that, and on the social media, and I think that was the first big thing, and I realised, bloody hell, I have to sort of be a bit of an influence on the next generation. It's not just asking about now, it's not just messing around, it's serious in a way that these kids are going to look up to you, and you've got to take your role seriously. And it's something I always wanted to do. I wanted to be, you know, professional in my job. I wanted to be a good role model, so I like taking the positive route, you know, not like talking crap and slagging opponents. I like take the positive and respectful route that kids should have a lot of respect and go down that route. But first time was probably about 4 or 5 years ago. I won the ABAs and stuff like that, but nothing has ever came of it like that. But when I turned pro about 2 years in or something like that, then it came, and then like people wanted to help me and support me, and it's a bit of a shock really. You're not accustomed to it, are you really? No one ever wanted to help me as a kid, and why would they don't know me. But it was hard to come accustomed to, a little bit of a shock, and
it's half like, it's half hard to believe, you know, it's hard, half hard to believe. Why does he want to help me? What's his agenda and stuff like that? But I go with it now, and you, I accept that these good people who actually want to help you, as I want to myself, you know. Like you say, doctors go home, don't they? They don't get nothing, do they? They get peanuts, 42. But, you know, a footballer or a boxer's never going to go home and say, save someone's life today. So they don't get the balance what they get, you know, they get the rewards in other ways. And I think that's one of the perks of being a boxer. You get the rewards as, like, you're a bit of a, how would I say, like, you know, like, people admire it, don't they? Do you like fighters? Oh, could you not? Look at me, my nose all over my face. My nose tucked in my ear, and it was just like, hey, you gotta respect boxers, haven't you? Because they work hard, and it's a hard, honest living, and I think you can only respect it hard and honest living, you know?
The unsung heroes of society, I think you're a bit of one for the underdog, are you?
Yeah, I love the community heroes, the small heroes who don't get a mention. The other day that Mo Salah was in Derry's gym, and his first reaction to the other hand was like, come on, you're lying. But I was trying to teach him, I was trying to tell him, look son, it's not about, Mo Salah, yeah, he is who he is, but then you have to understand that there's real heroes in life, you know, and they're not on the football pitch, they're in the youth clubs where they have been for the last 20 years, and they're in the, like, they're giving the time up in the football clubs. Your manager of a weekend, he turns up at 9 o'clock, freezing cold on Sunday morning. Your football manager, these are the heroes who you... I don't like pushing on them, but I want them to understand that they are the real heroes, you know? Mm-hmm. Not these people who everybody idolise, sort of thing.
Right, we're going to go in there. You're going to go and get a shave on
that. Is that bad? That you're making me go and get a shave.
Let's get in the barbershop. So who are these in here about this? Tell us before we go
in. The barbershop where we're going now is my sponsor. He's been sponsoring me for a few years now. And even toughest times in my career was when I fought for the world title. After I broke my jaw and I knew we weren't going to fight for 6 months. But lucky to have people like these where we're going to go now. We're going to meet them. And lucky to have people like him who say, you know what, he's not going to fight. And there's nothing in it for me to sponsor them, but they did, you know, and give me an help me not to go and have to work myself, not shy to work, but to stay in the gym and to do what I've got to do, and just support me, proper genuine support. That's what it is, and that's where we're gonna go now. And when you're gonna make me have a shave?
Yeah, let's go.
Come on then, boys.
I know I'm short. The fuck off.
What do you usually have then, Jazz? What's what you having today?
Two. On the side and a non on the top. Big ball, he's back all in there. He goes back fast up. Two is it? I don't know.
Yeah, Teddy, so. Is that even your corner?
Yeah,
gone?
He has to sort it though. He said there's a post one, but there isn't.
As long as we've got arsenal, you're going down, aren't you, John?
No, Steve, we're here at your barbershop. Jazza, you know, he says he helps him out over the years with his career, and, you know, give him a bit of backing, and obviously give him the old haircut, but only also help him out in between fights. As you know, and you've said it's hard for boxers.
He doesn't come here for the haircut no more. Do you? You never look that funny, is it?
No, I'm only messing.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah. What's your involvement with Jazza? How did you first get involved with him?
Do you know what? I don't even actually know how the sponsorship came. I mean, obviously I've known him from coming in, you know, over the years and all that. And, it was just kind of like one day. I think we were just talking, weren't we, Jazza? After.
I was fighting the day, yeah.
Was you fighting on the day, was you? Yeah. Just happened, you know what I mean? Just talking about boxing, and then it was a case of just like, you know, how you do with sponsors and stuff, and then because, like, you know, I didn't understand how hard it was to get sponsorships and for these lads to you know, to get income type of thing from the, you know what I mean? It's just, there's no structure in places even in boxing for these lads, and the sacrifice that they're making and all that, and it's, you know,
it is
hard. I just couldn't understand that. You know, there's no structure, no pay, nothing like that. It's just they're just relying basically on the sponsors and on fights. And you know how hard it is yourself, even just getting fights for some of them. It's a tough game to be in, but I say top lad and all that. And you know, the main thing is helping him out. You know, local lads. You know, wears his arse on his sleeve. You know, it's, so yeah, just been with them ever since, and say made a great friend from it and stuff. So yeah, all good.
Snickers on.
You got snickers.
Yeah.
Fair enough, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's a lot of boxers who not boxing fans or don't know a lot about it. You know.
But you do watch the hardcore old fights.
I watched like the 50s, probably the 70s. Not after the 70s or the 80s, really. I don't really.
That was my era. Yeah.
But I do really like anything before then.
Yeah.
Marvin Hagler and the old footage.
I don't know where to put it. No,
it didn't have his name on it, but I wonder if that's exactly the same.
It was a
fight for
Box Nation, and it was from like 2000
and... Really? I think 2015 or something. So you got the rematch reward, that's... So, any kind of, you know, would it this year, sometime?
Yeah, Frank Warren's won the first bid, so it's got to be over probably like the next 12 weeks, but the board of the rematch and the fight's definitely on, like, the rematch is on. So I'm having a warm fight, he's having a warm fight. And then I'll be on it.
He's having one, you're having one, and we'll go from there. It was one of them fights, wasn't it? But as the fight wore on, you was coming on stronger. It was almost like the second half, you was, you know, pulling away there, and then that was just a freak sort of accident, really, wasn't it? That happened, you know.
Yeah, it was a bit of a strange one. And when I got home that night, it was like, did I win, did I lose? Did he quit? Did I quit? You know what I mean? It's like, what happened there? But definitely time slowed down for them, and I was coming on strong.
Was you aware of the rules at that? You know, when the fight got stopped?
Yeah.
Was you aware that it's going to go to the scorecards at that point?
Right away. I knew it was going to go to the scorecards, because I'd seen it happen a few years earlier with Paul Edwards, Liverpool fighter. Remember he boxed Shinny Bayard? It happened then, and so I knew. But I knew where it was on points. I knew he'd be up about two rounds, but I knew I was coming on strong. I knew at that point when he went down. I actually knew when he went down, he's not getting up him. He's knackered, he's spent. I seen the cut and I thought, that's his way out. I knew it. That's when my heart sunk at that point. When he turned his head and his head was bleeding, I thought he's going to play on that now. Because if he was down on points, he wouldn't have got out. No way.
And did you feel like you was behind at that point? Did you feel you was coming back into it? So you knew if it was going to go scorecards, it was a chance.
I knew I was 2 points behind. I knew I was 2 points behind at the time. And that's what it was when the score got announced. I knew I was 2 points behind with that round, which I was winning, which I was 1 point behind, and two rounds after that. I knew where it was in the fight.
You feel that in the fight, and you know when you've exactly dropped around and when you pick
If you think in the fight, like, a lot of fighters don't, do they? Yeah. They'll have to think of water, they'll have to kind of breathe out of the air, they'll ask them what round it is.
You always know what round it is, you always know exactly, you know, the last 20 seconds of a round, you time all that.
Yeah, you know what you're like, you don't sort of say, right, you don't sort of say it's 110, 115 to me, it's more like he's one up there, or there's no more than two rounds in it, or I know I've won that one. Just count it like that.
You know, when some trainers say, take a round off here and stuff like, do you ever, can you do that? Can you judge a fight that much where you can take a round off and
and that kind of thing, you know, when you know, mid fight and then come on stronger the next round. Have you got, is that just through experience where you can do stuff like
that? You can take a round off without losing a round as well, you know.
Yeah.
Someone put pressure on, but not get into it so much. You still won the round, looks like you've done more work, but you've had the rest. You haven't done as much, but you have took the round off and you let it go again. Whereas he was working that round. I think taking a round off and then taking a round off whilst he takes rounds off is pointless. I think taking rounds off, you should also make him work, you know. What's the point otherwise?
Are they the sort of things you pick up through experience after you're getting in double figure fights and every fight you're learning all the time?
Since you start fighting championship fights, you've got that extra bit of experience and knowledge. If you don't take it, then what? You're stupid, aren't you? If you don't take that knowledge.
Mm.
But that's the advantage that you have got over the fighters you haven't yet done them. So Ward's now done 12 rounds, so I expect him to be a lot better, a lot more wise and shrewder, you know, a lot more confident in his fitness.
Mm-hmm. Will you approach the rematch differently with Ward?
Yeah, definitely. He comes to change everything's changed for me. I'll be boxing a lot sharper, a lot stronger and a lot more cleverer. Definitely more smarter.
And a different outcome for you.
You don't realise, you know, not when you lose the belt, you don't realise what it meant until you lost it. It's sickening going home when you haven't got it. You were in the car with me, Steve, weren't you, that night? Coming home.
What was that?
You were in the car with me coming home when I was the belt, weren't you? Just like, you just realise how much it did mean to you when you lost it, you know. And I'm alright talking about that, you know, because I'm confident that I'll get it back.
I think it was just the way it went, you know, it was so, I didn't even know what was happening. What happened? You know what I mean? It didn't even have to play on it. They knew straight away, they wanted that fight over straight away. It didn't go on much longer, did it?
No.
It was just a case of we won out, yeah, that's, you know, those the scorecards, you know,
where that.
I mean, you know, people can say, you know, some people might say he started a bit slow, whatever, but I think you watched the fight again. It wasn't the case that, it was the way Ward, he didn't want to engage, did he much? He was, you know, fighting on the back foot, the jab, and, you know, trying to win a few rounds with that, and but then as the fight was drawn on, you could see, the, you know what I mean, the strength, and you could see how, where the fight was going. It was just, it was that unfortunate what happened. It was
Well, give him his due, like.
But he was,
done well, didn't he? Yeah. Got a lot of respect for them. Him and his brother, fought his brother, the same title the year before. Got a lot of respect for him and the family, but. Business in anyone. Business. Not a bad part. Got to stay focused, though, all fighting Friday night. You have to stay.
You can't take your mind off that, no.
Talking about him feels like an insult. You know, like, to fight Friday night.
Yeah. And you've got to do that, haven't you? As a boxer, you can never look beyond anybody. You know, anyone can spring, you know, the thing. You know, like looking at your first British title defeat, and you know the defeats that you've suffered, that world title you've got to do, and going into this last one, and then you know you've had a bit of bad luck. It's not always necessarily, you know, it's been a bit of bad luck to say the least, but. You know, as a person, is it the strength you take from that? Because I mean, what could you learn from, you know, the fight ending as a cut? But it's just the experience you've had throughout all the fights that make you deal with these things better and you know, become a better boxer.
Really. It's a test of character, but I've had a lot of good luck as well. You know, that's obviously you've got to learn. I think you've learned some, you learn some. That's it for me. You just got to keep going forward. Any time I can get off this ride, you know. I want to keep going to get what I want. That's why I'm doing it. I want to win the world title, and that's that.
Yeah, tell us about this cryotherapy that we're going to, Jazza. You know, what? How does it work for you? That, and you know, how long you've been doing it? What does it do?
Been doing it for a few years now. It works right away. The cryotherapy chamber. So it's like a blast of ice, nitrogen, and it. It like reboots your sort of thing, so it's, I think it sends all your blood to your core and it flushes the system out and so sends out new blood to your body. So you go in there, you come out feeling brand new. That's where we're going now. Looking forward to it. Get a bit of energy afterwards and
last week at camp, and it's good to feel good and make myself feel good. Fighting 4 days, so little things like this, I think, go a long way. Good, lucky there to have a sponsor like this.
It's the same idea as an ice bath and that it's cold to help the body recover from training and exercise. And it does that by taking all the toxins out of the blood, and like flushing the toxins out of the blood, including like lactic acid and all that, you know what I mean? Because when you train, your body builds up lactic acid, doesn't it? And that's what makes you sore and makes you stiff, isn't it? So the more of that you can get out of yourself, the better you can recover, and the more you're gonna get out of your sessions, isn't it? So that's how it helps to flush lactic acid, to reduce lactic acid.
I just get in feeling like crap and get out feeling great.
Yeah.
Really? Is it?
I don't know the science behind them. Okay. I just get punched, get in, get out.
So you actually feel the benefits, Jazz, when you've got out of it, you can, your muscles.
You feel it straight away, yeah.
I've done marathons, a few marathons, because I'm coming in after it, and coming out of the marathon, feeling great. Mm. Couldn't squat before I got in, came out, that's how I know it.
You can see as it's running out, this is nitrogen gas. And you can, that's the temperature there, so it's cooling down now. It starts at zero, now it's going on to like minus 120. I know, so that's ready for now, minus 130, we're ready.
Wow.
So when you're ready.
Can you film me or not, please, Dad? Yeah. I'm going to put on my
Do you want to get your gloves on?
Oh, yeah.
You're going in.
Going in to deep end. Side. You're too high there, you know. Take a step off.
If you get that side, I mean,
you get the temperature.
How cold can you go?
That's the temperature now. See, it's dropping down to minus 130. The machine's up at 130, so what it does, it'll come back down to 130, keep it on stand. And it'll top up again, so it'll go to about now, about 140, 150. Let's see where it goes.
You feeling that?
That's degrees Celsius. It's obviously freezing, but it's not as horrible as you might think, because it's not wet, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's completely dry, so it is freezing, don't get me wrong. And it is painful, isn't it?
Yeah.
But you can live with it. Whereas if you get an ice bath, which is obviously wet because it's water, you can't live with that, can you?
Yeah, because that takes your breath, doesn't it? Yeah. If you get an ice bath.
This just takes your balls.
Like I say, it's freezing and it's painful, but you can live with it. Whereas with an ice bath, you can't live with that.
So you won't perform very well after getting out of one of them, as in...
You feel good coming out of it, though.
Really? Yeah. Where are you feeling it? Is it like, does it gradually come on you, the cold? Is it an instant hit?
Your chest, feel low on your chest, and you know your major muscles.
Mostly the lower half, isn't it? Your calves, I think, for me.
Yeah. Calves, your quads, biceps, chest, back.
How long have you been doing this?
2 years then.
Bam, 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 bam. You can see now it's on 160. But like I said, the machine's up at 130, so it's on its way back down. You can see the gas, it peaks at 160, and then the gas starts to evaporate. You can see it disappearing, can't you? So as it's evaporating, it's losing a bit of coldness, if you see what I mean. And if you look at the temperature, it'll go back down to 130 and it'll top up again now. The machine's up at 130, like I said. Yeah, there it goes, it comes in again. And then it comes in thicker, like I say. See it just coming out and disappearing in front of you? Because it evaporates when it meets the fresh air.
This is the same machine that they used to use on Stars in Your Eyes years ago.
Yeah, right. Tonight, Matthew, I'm going to be Jazza Dickens. Yeah.
There you go, man.
Your teeth are not chattering or anything.
got me gummy in.
modern training methods.
Science.
Get it off. So you've only done 3 minutes in there then, haven't you?
Yeah. One round?
Yeah.
One times 3 minute round.
With no breaks?
No break in between. Last 10 at the end.
So you obviously after training you ache, your muscles are always killing. Is that kind of a relief then for your muscles? And like you just said, you couldn't do squats before, and since you come out of there,
yeah.
You know, your legs are feeling better and your muscles. Is that?
Yeah, you feel brand new. Just feel proper brand new. Feel good again. You forget how you felt before you went in there. I'd recommend it to anyone, especially in boxing. This sport, like you live your life feeling sore, don't you? Your whole life's sore. You wake up sore from yesterday, and you go. Yeah. And saying that, and tomorrow you wake up feeling even sore from 2 days ago. So it's like, it's important to have a bit of recovery too. I think it all works together, your diet, your nutrition, your rest, and your training. So get one of them in there.
You said the other day you live in pain.
Yeah.
You're always in pain. Yeah.
You just get used to it. After so many weeks, six to eight weeks, you just live in pain, and then you come to the end of a camp like I am now, and you're in the last week and you're not going to train hard now, you're just going to sharpen up, and it's a bit strange. You're just like, what are we doing now? You're looking for things to do and stuff like that, but at the same time you've got to be disciplined to get your rest.
What's the hardest thing of being a pro boxer for you?
For me, the hardest thing about being a boxer is this sacrifice. I've got a 9-year-old, a 3-year-old, and a 2-year-old. I've got 3 kids, and it's just the sacrifice. It just kills you. You're going to bed, and the kids are saying, "Daddy, Daddy," and Daddy's going to bed, and like the kids say to me, "Where are you going?" You know, going to the gym and a bit like disappointed and stuff like that. So it's hard to come away from my family. I love my family more than anything. But yeah, boxing gets more time. So it's just like the sacrifice, it's a little sacrifice. A lot of fighters will tell you that it's the diet or the training. But I think it's the sacrifice of, you get used to that, but you never get used to leaving your kids, you know. You can't get used to the pain. It's unbelievable for me personally. But you know, it'll be worth it for them, hopefully one day, and hopefully that they've got a job they can be proud of, you know, someone doing positive things in life, positive role model.
Absolutely. Is that what drives you on, Jazz? I've heard you say a few times, you know, it's being a world champion, you've said it, you always say, you know, you're reaching that pinnacle. Is it, have you always been like, anything you put your mind to, you want to be the best at?
Yeah, I think, especially in this game, there's no place for number two. So like, no one ever remembered number two really in boxing. It's just all champions in it. That's all it is. No one cares unless you're the champ. So that's all it is for boxing. And I don't know, I've always had this passion. I can't really find out what it is myself, why I want to do it, why I want to be the world champion, why I want to push myself so hard and so far. I probably might never know why I do it. But I do know it's not for anyone else. It's not for my family. I think that they will get the benefits and reap the rewards, providing it all goes how I see it going. But I don't think that it's for anyone else. It's just like a personal thing for me. It's just the mission that says, you know, a plan that I have from when I was a kid, and I'm still sticking to it now. It's just been the same. I've been doing this since I was 13. Same before, in pain. Been in pain for most of my life, you know. It never gets easy. You just get stronger and fitter. And that's what it's been like for years, since I was a kid, really. Literally a kid. I had no teenage years having fun like a lot of other people. I just had boxing. You know, same day. So like, the weekend comes and people think it's like this, the weekend, but I sit at home at the weekend thinking the gym's not open. That's because I don't think you can really regret sacrifices, can you?
No.
It's not something that you really regret. You get rewards from them, you reap the benefits, so
yeah.
I'm happy with living the life I am in boxing. And my kids like it, my family like it, you know, it's a nice way to live, it's a very disciplined lifestyle.
A day in the life of Jazza there, we've done a bit, it's not over yet, but you know, good day at the gym, and then in the cold chamber.
Yes, we need to do.
You've enjoyed it.
Yeah, we need to sing now, don't we, like James Corden?
Yeah.
Why don't
I? I was thinking of that karaoke interviews. Yeah, that'd be good. That you have to pick your fame. He's got a bit of I noticed on here a bit of Paul Simon, didn't you?
Oh yeah. Say Paul Simon.
I don't mind a bit of Paul Simon. Yeah.
Class, real class.
You can call me Al. If you want.